This is PanzerKill 13. In today's video, we will be painting the what is known the third jump smock for the Fallschirm Jägers, the camouflage on them, the third model smock camouflage, and I will be explaining where I got the references from that and what have you. This video is being made because I had a request from a couple of friends on my Facebook page. And I want to welcome all of the Facebook modeling pages, Tamiya modeling page on Facebook, Plastic Model Builders Group modeling page on Facebook, Facebook Model Society modeling page on Facebook, Military modeling page on Facebook, Modeling World War II, and World War II Diorama Art. And there are just so many. I'll get to some of the other ones the next time. I'm giving out shoutouts to everybody and a good welcome. I have a good friend, and he asked me if I could do a video on how I painted the Fallschirm Jäger uniforms, which are on my Normandy dio and also my Ardennes Out of Juice diorama. And I'm going to be showing you the references, and I'm going to be showing you the pictures. I have colored photographs to get the colors of the uniform as close as possible. And I'm going to be showing you the techniques that I used here, along with pictures of the finished, not this particular figure that I'm doing here, because it's going to take me a while, but pictures of finished Fallschirm Jäger camouflage uniforms. And not really only Fallschirm Jägers, because that particular camouflage that's on the third smock was also used by Volksgrenadier divisions, and it was also used by the Gebirgsjäger divisions from mid 43 onward, I believe it is. I'm not exactly sure. I'd have to go back to the book to be exactly sure, but I think it was like early to mid 43 is when they went to that splinter. It's not even a splinter camouflage. It's more of a different type of right angle shape camouflage. And you'll see in the video, I'm gonna do a how-to step by step and what paints I use and what have you. Nevertheless, let's get started, and I hope you enjoy the video. At the end, comment, PM me if you have any questions, and share it and subscribe for more videos. Until then, enjoy the video. PanzerKill 13 out. Okay, today we are going to be painting our Fallsherm Jaegers. Again, I was asked by request to do this video. A friend called Detlef Krohn from Germany, and he has seen some of my other dioramas, like the Normandy diorama that Gunther Meyer signed, and the fifth Fallsherm Jaeger division diorama, the In the Snow, the Ardennes one. And he asked me if I could do a video to show how to paint the Fallsherm Jaeger camouflage. Now, the Fallsherm Jaeger camouflage, the official name of the smock was the third model smock. The first model and the second model were of a light pea to field gray green type of color. And then they went to this, it's not a splinter. I don't like to call it splinter, but it is a different hexagonal, and not really hexagonal, just a basically hard-edged right angle shape camouflage. And they produced the camouflage smocks in two colors, one being like a pea avocado green base one, as you can see here in this book, and the other one being the more darker brownish. It's a more darker brownish one that you're going to get to see. Now, the reference that I used for my figures that I painted and that I will be painting today is I have four books that gave me very good reference. This one here was purchased in like 1999, and it has very good, very, very good pictures. It does not have any color pictures, but as you can see here, pretty much the color is very correct here. And what the camouflage consists of is this pea avocado green. And then what I normally use for the green and brown is the straight Panzer three-tone camo, red, brown, and dark green. And I'll be showing you right now the paints that I use for it, so that, because people are gonna say, well, what paints do you use? I use Tamiya paints. Oh, excuse me. And for the base, I mix my own as close to that color as I possibly can. I mix a big batch, so I have enough for several several projects. And I also mix the base for the brown that I use. Now, the brown that I use for two types of uniforms that are German. One for Africa Corps, and then which I lighten up, and I use it for the Fallsherm Jaeger. Here is the base color for the brown uniform on the Fallsherm Jaegers. When I use it for Africa Corps, I lighten it up with white to give it faded look. And here is my green that I've mixed, which is the pea green color here. And on both smocks, the green and brown camouflage is, I use Tamiya 61, XF61 flat dark green. I always use this for all of my armored vehicles that are German that take three-tone camo. And I use it for the camouflage for the green, representing the green on the vehicles, and also on my Fallsherm Jaegers. And for the brown, I use Tamiya XF64 red brown, right out of the bottle. These here are right out of the bottle. I do not lighten them up, or I do not anything. I just shoot them straight through out of the bottle, and they work perfect. I'm going to show you. Here is the Semovente that the Fallsherm Jaegers are going to be in. And I used my own mix of dark yellow, but the green and the brown are XF61 for the dark green, and Tamiya red brown for the brown right out of the bottle. And it works excellent, as you can see. That is the same paint that I use for the Fallstream Jaeger uniforms, which are these. Now again, back to the books. These books here have excellent, I mean, excellent pictures. It gives you all of the Luftwaffe. It has a whole section for the Fallstream Jaeger. It's in a two-part. This is volume two. As you can see, volume one is has just the Luftwaffe, and this one has Fallstream Jaegers and stuff like that, Luftwaffe divisions. Nevertheless, I liked it because it had the color rendition here of the uniform, and you can see clearly it's like an avocado green. Again, I mix my own, and I try to get it as close as possible. Remember, I had a friend, and we were putting a project together, and he wanted to make it exactly. This is an interpretation of this color. Always go by an interpretation. If you want to make it exactly the color exactly, you're going to waste hundreds of hours, countless amount of time. And in the end, you've seen my results. They're close enough and good enough. And good enough to win, awards at the IPMS championship level. So, you know, you're never going to make it exact. Get it as close as possible. And then go ahead and do your painting. Another book that I have is this book. It was also purchased about 14 years ago. And it has uniforms from World War II to the present day, including DDR, the Fleck Tarn camouflage that the now Bundeswehr uses. And it has a colored picture, but it's not very good, of the camouflage on the smocks. Now you have to remember that that particular camouflage wasn't unique just to the Fallstream Jaegers. The Mountain Divisions received it, and also the Volksgrenadier Divisions received it. And there is the picture there. It's not a very good quality, but it's the green base smock, and you can see more or less how it kind of looks. I've got colored pictures, don't worry, I'm gonna get to that. But this book here is another reference that I used whenever I'm gonna do any kind of German uniform or whatever. Another reference that I use is this book here, which Gunther Meyer of the 3rd Fallstream Jaeger Division, and I've gone through that already in my other video, he autographed for me. But this one chronicles pretty much all of the Fallstream Jaeger operations of World War II, from the beginning to Crete, Ebenemel, all of these, in Norway. I mean, it chronicles all of them. There's no colored photographs, but you can see they're very nice and crisp, and you can see the photographs, even in black and white, show good detail. The best one, the best book that I've ever found for any kind of colored reference was actually a book that I bought at a bookstore that's a commercial bookstore. It's not a military type of bookstore, the kind that we like to go to and stuff, but it's this book. I bought it at, I believe, Borders or one of those commercial bookstores at the mall. I bought it in 1993, and I liked it because it has a lot of colored reference for British uniforms, American uniforms, SS uniforms, and even the Fallstream Jaeger smock. That was my favorite. On page 202, I don't know if this book's available anymore, but it's beat up. I mean, I bought it in 93. It's over 20 years old. See, even the cover has ripped off or whatever. I keep it. I never get rid of it because it has such good quality detail and good. On page 202, you have the brown Fallstream Jaeger smock in color. Let me see if I can move the light to get the glare out. There you go. In color. And you can see all of the detail on it. You can see all of the shapes. You know, they asked me, how do you do it? Again, remember, we're going to do an interpretation of this. It's not going to be exactly like it. If you want to do exactly like it, you're going to be taking forever at the small scale. But if you can see, here's the base color to the brown one, which is what I use here, and here's the base color to the green one. In these ammo pouches here are in the base green color, so you're getting colored reference. And again, that's an interpretation. Not gonna get it exactly. This is faded, this is faded. They're not brand new. They're captured from D-Day in Normandy. But nevertheless, you're getting nice reference here for a Mauser. This is what the 9mm pouches for the Schmeisser look like in color. And this is what the camouflage splinter color. Again, here's my dark green Tamiya XF61. Here's my red brown XF64. And then here's the base color. And this is the color that the Africa Corps uniforms actually were, simulating that he was a Fallschirm Jäger based in Africa or whatever. You know, they're just giving you reference here. But nevertheless, you can see the excellent detail. And what the shapes are just straight angles. And we're going to show you, when I start painting them, you're not going to get them exactly correct. If you see the raindrop camo here that later on the East German forces used here, I mean, you're going to get a rendition and you're going to get an interpretation. But if you want to make every single little tiny line in 1/35 scale or even 1/72 scale, you're going to pretty much take a whole year on one figure. And that's not what we're trying to do. We give you an interpretation. And to the naked eye in 1/35 scale, it looks good and it passes the test, right? It's passed the test with everybody. Everybody likes my Fallschirm Jäger dioramas and they like the figures, and the good old Gunther Meyer himself approved of it. So nevertheless, this is what I use for reference. I keep this book forever because it has reference in color for British uniforms of D-Day, American uniforms. I mean, it's chock full of good stuff, and I can't believe that, you know, an average mall store had this thing for sale. And here's some American uniforms, and here's the paratrooper, real, the authentic, what someone wore in World War II. Here's the real colors here. You know, it just goes on and on and on. Here's a British paratrooper, and I'm doing I'm in a Arnhem, actually Market Garden build off on a it's military modeling on Facebook, military modeling Facebook page, and I'm going to be using this reference and some other ones in here because I'm gonna do the good old Brits at Arnhem fighting Beatrix 10th SS. Nevertheless, you know, again, this is the book that I used, and you've seen, this is what it looks like. If you can find it on eBay or whatever, get yourself a copy because it's chock full of colored reference for a lot of stuff. I won't take any more time here. I want to get into the figures and what have you, but nevertheless, this is the reference that I used. And it's been very good reference for me. There's countless pictures also on the internet. But as you can see, this book here and this one here with the color rendition here is very good. This is dark gray. Some of them used field gray, some of them used dark gray. So that you know, you're gonna see a variation of different combinations. I'm gonna show you the figures now. They're base painted already. And I'm going to move these guys over. And I want to show you. I've shown you the paints. Again, this is what I use for my base green. This is what I use for my base brown. And for the splinters, I use that and that. That's what I use for my Fallschirm Jäger, Volksgrenadier, or anybody else that wore that type of camouflage. Those are the ones that I use. Now, let's move these out of the way here. I'm going to bring the figures in. The figures have been painted base already, meaning I painted the base coats for camouflage. Now, again, here is, and I'm going to put the camera on the tripod. Here is one done in the green base. And, you know, if you can see here, you're not going to get it exactly, but after weathering and after washes and stuff, you'll get it close. And also, I'm modeling these guys here as just recently issued. They're going to be in the Semovente, and it's going to be part of the Anzio Nettuno diorama that I'm doing with the Jagdpanzer elephant. The Semovente is going to be in there, and there's going to be also a dragon, early A panther in Italy, the issue that they set off about 12, 14 years ago. I have about three of those, so nevertheless, this is the Semovente that these guys are going to be in and around. They're not all going to be inside because I want to show the interior, and that's why I went all out on the Semovente. I'm going to show you one of the Fallschirmjägers is already seated in there. He's already finished, and I'm going to show you what it looks like. He's in base green. I did three and three to begin with, but there's going to be a couple more, so it'll probably end up an odd number, like maybe four green and five brown, or five green and four brown. Who knows? You know, I got to see how many other figures I'm putting in there. But this is the brown guys, and this guy here is a Verlinden figure you can buy, and it's a single figure that you buy, and he's like about $8 at Verlinden on eBay, and he comes with like four heads, five different type of arms, different, you can pose them in different positions. He's different. I mean, he comes with a ton of stuff, and you can pose him in different, he's going to be eating and drinking something, so they're going to be like on break. Anzio Nettuno before the battle. They're not going to be in battle. That's why the Semovente is not beat up. The inside's beat up because when the Italians turned them over, you know, the German shops, you know, they just redid the outside and put their own radios in and stuff like that. But it wasn't like they redid the whole thing. If it ran and it worked, they weren't going to waste any time redoing it or whatever. They just did the outside and made them all uniform or whatever. But again, these are the figures that we're going to be painting, and the splinter camouflage. Now, the way I do it is, and you're going to see once we start painting, I use synthetic brushes. I have sable for contours and roundness, like when I'm painting a face or whatever. I also use synthetics, but I like synthetics because they're nylon, they're stiff, and they hold their shape. You can put them flat, you can flatten the tip out with your fingers, and it holds flat, and you can have a lot more control. And for this type of camouflage, the splinter, we're going to need a flat thing to make the square shapes. Now, again, you're never going to make it, and you can if you want, exactly like this. I mean, every shape is different. What I try to do is I try to just generalize the shapes between triangles and rectangles and squares, and then I'll put a couple of those raindrop lines or whatever. But I mean, I don't do it exactly like that. It comes out really good. People agree with the results. Now I'm going to show you the guy that's in there already. And this is not glued because there's going to be another guy gluing it in there, which is going to be the commander here, who is going to be talking to the commander of the Jagdpanzer. But if you can see here, he's in there already. And let me see if I can get some more light on him. Let's see if I can bring him back. And you can see I did him in the base green, and I don't know if the camera's picking it up, but let me see. I'm going to point a couple of things out here. I promise I'm going to put it on the tripod.
You can see here the shapes of it. And I'm going to be putting more pictures of the other Fallschirmjägers and what have you. A little better angle there. Yeah, nevertheless, you get the idea, and we'll start with our paint now. Okay, here's the guy that we're going to be painting the Fallschirmjäger camouflage on. And I'm going to do him next because he's actually the commander. And he's going to be inside the Semovente. He's the last guy inside the Semovente. He's going to be talking to the commander of the Jagdpanzer Elephant. And so I want to finish off whatever's in the Semovente because I want to close it up and finish the model itself. I've been putting together the model cast and track links, and this guy will go in there, and then it'll get closed off. Actually, it'll get closed off before this guy goes in there, but I need to finish him up because I gotta position him to see how I'm gonna glue him or whatever. Nevertheless, he's already been base coat painted in our brown and dark gray. Here's these guys here. This guy here's in the pea green with field gray. So the combinations, you know, you're going to be correct if you do any of those combinations. And since this is brown, we're going to start off with our green first. And what we're going to do is we shake our paint. And then we proceed to open it. Normally, I'll thin the paint down, but since I know I've been using this dark green here for my Russian vehicles and all of that stuff, I know that it's pretty much mixed up and not as thick as normal to me a paint comes, but for a fine type of painting, you wanna thin it out. Now, again, we're gonna do an interpretation. I'm starting with the green first, and then we're gonna proceed to the brown, and then the red-brown raindrops come later. Okay. My paint is ready. I'm going to be painting the shapes with a synthetic flat tip. I have a synthetic very fine tip, and then I have a synthetic blunt, which is this one here. I have different sizes, but this is the size I like to do these shapes with, and it holds its shape and you can control it really nice. And that's what we're going to be doing here. Bring my light over more, down, and here we go, guys. It's not expensive. It's not hard. It's nothing out of the ordinary. Just take patience. Dip your brush just a little bit. I like to start at the edges here. The paint is really dry. Why is that? Or not wet enough. Okay. And you may have to give it more than one coat, as we're soon seeing here. Remember, they're angles, not square, but flat angles. There's no roundness in these shapes. So, here we go. You're not incorrect in giving it different. Again, it's not really square, but just angles, you know? There's the first shape, see? And then you just, you fill it in. Right here at the bottom. And then all you do is just fill it in. Very easy, guys. Nothing out of the ordinary. Again, it's not going to be exactly as the book, exactly as the pictures. It's an interpretation. Because if I were to try to make every little tiny little shape here, forget it. We would never be done with this figure. As long as there are shapes that kind of match what you're doing, that's fine. I'm not going to tell you, go, you know, you're not incorrect. Don't go and put roundness on them or a star or, you know, because then you are incorrect. But keep the edges straight and uniform. Don't show any roundness. And you're all right. I don't know if you can see that there, but it's hard to paint when I'm on camera because I'm not at the right angle that I want to be. But nevertheless, that's the first guy here. And the folds you can put pretty much. I think it's a bigger shape. You're not gonna be wrong because the folds actually distort the shape. Just make straight angles. Up here we'll get the lip of the, see how nice the synthetic holds its shape? Here we'll go like this. I'll give this a pointy. And it starts taking shape, see? And there is no right or wrong. At the some of the edges, you want to put like, if you see here, I have green. On the other side, it's not going to have green, it's going to have brown. That way you denote sections of fabric that goes in different directions and what have you. like on the bands here, the pant bands, we'll put some green here. And paint straight. Right to the line. And what I'm gonna do on the other side line, I passed the line a little bit, but don't worry. Never panic. Because what I'm gonna do on the other side of the line is I'm gonna do brown. See? Our camouflage is starting to take shape. Just keep your brush flat. The synthetic is beautiful for this job because it's just a flat trajectory here. I'll do the thing right here, watch. The corner of the pocket, and it'll have brown to denote that it's a different fabric on the other side or what have you. See how the brush holds its shape? That's why I like synthetics for this type of work. Once in a while, dip it in our alcohol. And again, I use Tamiya. You can use anything. I had a question from a gentleman that said, I have Vallejo, and do you think it'll work? These are acrylic paints, acrylic enamel. So basically, acrylic paint, see? Any acrylic paint is going to follow the same formula. It doesn't matter if it's Tamiya or Vallejo or what have you. It's going to follow the same formula. If you've been looking at my videos on how to weather, how to paint, how to everything, it's going to follow the same formula. Give them a little triangle right here. See how nice the synthetic holds its shape? You know, and you have to, once you get to know what you're working with, and how it's going to interact and what it's going to do and if it's going to show. This guy's exactly not going to even show from maybe the chest down because he's going to be inside, standing inside of the vehicle. So I'm doing it really, really carefully. But if I wasn't making a video, I probably wouldn't be this careful because it's not going to show. Even when the judges look in there and with their little flashlights, it's not going to show. I'm gonna give him a bigger shape here.
See? And there is no right or wrong. There's no right or wrong. Once it gets all put together, the result is going to be very nice. You're not going to get it exactly. Don't, if you're a beginner, do not try to get it exactly. Again, I had a friend. We were doing a project for IPMS Nationals, and we were doing a Luftwaffe airfield, and he wanted the bushes to look exactly like they did in the picture. And I'm going to be honest with you. All of my dioramas, they're interpretations. They don't look exactly. Because if that was the case, you're never going to finish anything. You're going to be stuck on one thing forever. So do the best you can. Do the best interpretation you can. And trust me, you're going to be okay with the results. I'm going to give him a green thing up here. Okay. Give him another green one here. See how you put it in a different spot and it denotes a different fabric, a different site. We're going to be doing that throughout this figure. Throughout all of the figures, I do it here on the smock band here. You can see I'm going to be putting brown up here and it'll show you that it's a different fabric altogether. And again, you don't want to do a bunch of them and overwhelm the you know, it's in 1/35 scale. You know, give a good interpretation and, you know, move on. Sometimes you want to just do it really quick. See the shapes. All it is hard angles. Boom, boom, boom. This one looks a little round, but we're gonna flatten them out. There we go. An interpretation, my friends. An interpretation is what we're looking for here. When I'm painting really fine, somebody asked me, what technique do I use? Breathe in, and when you exhale completely, then you paint. That's when your heart rate is the slowest. Our Simovinta commander is coming along. He'll later on be cleared. Now I'm going to do the brown. Very easy, guys. It's not going to take a long video here. I'm going to do the brown to show you how it interacts. Very, very simple. To do the Fallstream Jaeger, Volks Grenadier, Mountain Camouflage. Once in a while, Tamiya's acrylic enamel, and they'll sell you their thinner at like $10, $12 US dollars a bottle. I don't like to do that. I found that there was alcohol and dishwashing soap in it. So all I use is now is alcohol, rubbing alcohol.
for final cleanup or running through my airbrush or thinning out to spray through the airbrush. You can buy a bottle of alcohol for like $1.50 and it lasts you 10 times longer than the Tamiya thinner. And it's just the same. I actually like the way it sprays out better than the Tamiya thinner. The Tamiya thinner has some kind of agent that it's a soap agent, but for some reason the it just doesn't come out as smooth as just with alcohol. You can control it better just with alcohol. I like the control I get with the alcohol. Sometimes the tops get stuck and you have to loosen them up with pliers or what have you. That's what you're hearing. Okay, so we're going to do our brown spots now. Same thing. Some of the brown spots will be next to the green. Some of them will be by themselves. But it's the same concept, same thing, same everything. Now let's put a brown spot right opposite the green here. Show you that it denotes a different piece of fabric. I don't know if you can see that, but nevertheless, it's very simple, guys. Not complicated, not rocket science. Just, you know, don't drink coffee before you paint. You know, don't have arguments, don't go jogging, don't have your heart beating super strong. It's very late here right now. It's like 2 in the morning. My wife is asleep. The house is really quiet. This is when I like to do most of my building. Not that my wife supports everything I do. She's great, but we're busy doing other things in the day, you know? See how nice? And then we're gonna finish off with our raindrop pattern. Very easy, guys. Just continue the line. See how it's nicely spaced? Sometimes you'll be able to put them next to each other because on the actual uniform they're like that. They're next to each other too. As you can see over here, but you know, you want to have space. See that? Beautiful. The synthetics. I love synthetic brushes. They hold their shape. If you make them flat, they're going to hold their shape flat and you can control it better. Pick up just a little bit of the paint. if I'm only at the right angle or not. See, so he's coming along. Just randomly have a picture of the reference and just randomly spread them out. And it's an interpretation. You know, we're trying to interpret it the best way we can. We're not going to ever make it exactly right, but the results are very liked because I've been asked to do it. So, again, I'm doing this for my Facebook friends. I don't claim that my way is the best. I don't claim that I'm the best. It's just my way. And I've been asked to do these videos for my friends. We're gonna get up on the puck here. Give this ring a partner. Right next to it. See that? Right next to it. You can put smaller shapes. There is no right or wrong, guys. Make a triangle here, watch. See how nice the synthetic brush just holds its shape? And the whole figure will get the hole going over. We'll put a shape here by our, we'll leave that big green thing. Brighten out our shape there. See, it's awesome. Very easy. Okay, so I'm showing you that there is no right or wrong on the shapes. Just get a picture. I'm gonna put the pictures, because I know I showed you the video, but I'm gonna put the pictures in the video of the reference on this book. I'm gonna take a picture of this and then take a picture of the colored photograph of the smock and put them in there. So for your reference, so you can download it or whatever. And just make an interpretation of it. That's all. Now, the way we do the raindrops, and with the synthetic, you're going to see how nice it goes. Very easy, you. I use the Tamiya tops all the time. And what I do, I thin out the paint a little more. And what I'll do is I'll take a couple of drops of water on my sable brush and just let them go in there. And then mix it. Make it really super thin. The thinner the better, because we're going to be doing our little raindrops right now. Now, since we have a synthetic brush, we're gonna pick up paint. It just sucks it right up. Hold your figure down and just lightly run it across. That's too big. We'll make that a shape, but look. Nope, too much. Okay. Let's thin it down a little. Let's get rid of some of the paint, but that the there we go. Barely touching it. There we go. I just had too much paint on the brush. Randomly just. It takes practice, and you're going to need practice, but just barely touch the figure. Barely. I mean, don't even put pressure, because I got big spots over here which will turn into shapes. Remember, don't panic. There's no right or wrong, you know? That's too big, but yeah, that's okay. There you go. There you go. There you go. As you start doing it, you get the hang of it. And to be honest with you, the raindrops take the longest because they're the smallest and you have to put a lot of them all over the place. I don't know if you can see that good, but I'm going to take pictures of him when he's done. But that's how you do the splinter camouflage. I'm going to put pictures of finished examples in this video so you can see it. And again, I'm going to take pictures of the references and put them in the video. Very easy, guys. Nothing out of the ordinary, nothing out of this world. Don't panic when you mess up. I messed up according to the rest of the world, but it won't look messed up when I'm done with these big thick ones, but they'll become one shape and it'll be fine. But if you can see here, you can see the little lines, and these synthetic brushes are excellent for those little lines. And that's how you go about doing the raindrops and the camouflage. Yeah, I hope you've enjoyed the video. Comment, rate it. If you have any questions, PM me. If you're on Facebook and you have any questions, PM me. And that's the conclusion of this video. Again, hope that it was helpful. Hope that you learned how to do the Fallstrom Jaeger camouflage. Again, I'm going to be putting out examples of finished, pictures of finished examples, so that you can see that it doesn't look exactly as the book, but it's an interpretation, and it's a very good interpretation. Here's the book, and I'm going to be taking a picture of this and putting it in the video also, for your reference, and the colored photograph of the book also. Nevertheless, hope the video was helpful. If you need any help, feel free to call me. I'm always willing to help. And again, happy modeling. Panzerkiel out.